Good evening. My name is Sean Hudgeonwardle, and I will be your moderator for this evening's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles, and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and gods many, but we now know that each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, nor Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world erroneously calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should all ask ourselves is, What was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today, we will have a prayer by our dean, Dr. Marlon Love, visiting with us on Zoom. And we will have that followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson will be the second chapter of James, and that will be read by Dr. Nanette Ramirez. Dr. Love.
Good evening, class. And I also bow our heart and mind in the moment of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father Yahweh, thank you once again for allowing us to gather together in person and via the internet, in order that we might tune in and quiet our hearts and our mind in order to once again learn more perfectly about your purpose, pattern, and plan according to all things that you've established before the creation of the world. These things and all other things that we ask in your only beloved Son's name, Yahshua Messiah, let us all say, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Good evening, class. I'll be reading James, the second chapter, and I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testaments, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Traina, the Scripture Research Association. James, the second chapter. My brethren, have not the faith of our glorious Savior, Yahshua the Messiah, with respect of persons. For if there come unto you, your assembly, a man with a gold ring and godly apparel, and there come in also a poor man in vile raiment, and ye have respect to him that weareth the gay clothing, and say unto him, sit thou here in a good place, and say to the poor, stand thou there, or sit here under my footstool. Are ye not then partial in yourselves, and are become judges of evil thoughts? Hearken, my beloved brethren, hath not Yahweh chosen the poor of this world, rich in faith, as heirs of the kingdom, which he hath promised to them that love him? But ye have despised the poor. Do not rich men oppress you, and draw you before the judgment seats? Do they not blaspheme that worthy name by the which ye are called? If ye fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, thou shalt love thy neighbor, and thyself ye do well. But if ye have respect to persons, ye commit sin, and are convinced of the law as transgressors. For whosoever shall keep the whole law, and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all. For he that said, do not commit adultery, said also, do not commit murder. Now if thou commit no adultery, yet if thou commit murder, thou art become a transgressor of the law. So speak ye, and so do, as they that shall be judged by the law of liberty. For he shall have judgment without mercy, that hath shown no mercy, and mercy rejoiceth against judgment. What doth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith, and have not works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warm and filled, notwithstanding ye give them not those things which are needful to the body, what doth it profit? Even so faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. Yea, a man may say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by works. Thou believest that there is one Elohim. Thou doest well. The demons also believe and tremble. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works, when he hath offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seest thou faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect? And the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, Abraham believeth Yahweh, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of Yahweh. Ye see then how that by works a man is justified, and not by faith only. Likewise also was not Rahab the hostess justified by works, when she had received the messengers and had sent them out another way? For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. I have read James, the second chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Love, and thank you, Dr. Ramirez. Tonight is Tuesday night. It's our workshop night. So since our dean is out of town visiting North and South Carolina, lucky him, I will be filling in as the instructor for tonight. Hopefully it's not me, and it is the spirit of Yahshua the Messiah that's doing the speaking, because I got nothing good to say at all. But with that being said, before we get started, if there are any questions, I kind of have an idea, something that we could get into. But, you know, if there's any questions, if there's anything that anybody wants to work with, then we can go into that and let that be our workshop, since we consider this like question and answers night. So if there's any questions. Okay. All right. So it's a pretty good scripture lesson. I picked that because I was looking at one of the pamphlets. We go into the pamphlets a lot on Tuesday. Dr. Love's kind of made it a thing for us to do that, and I appreciate that, because you know we need to study these things. We have them, and what is good about having them if we don't actually utilize them and go through them and review them and learn something about you know what is written in these pamphlets. You know, this is, after all, a school, and it's not a church. This is some place where we should be learning something. And I was listening in earlier to Springfield on the Zoom, and it was really good. Both speakers were really, really good. The second speaker said something that really resonated with me, though, and I was driving on into class while I was on the Zoom, and I tried to say something, but for some reason my signal was going in and out, so I couldn't say anything. So I guess I'll say it now, and if he gets to hear it, then, you know, awesome. But Dr. Lamar Rhodes was speaking, and he was under the teaching from the founder of the school, from Dr. Kinley. And he was recollecting one time that he was talking face to face with Dr. Kinley, and Doc said to him that Yahweh is not going to make any excuses for our ignorance at all. No excuses at all for our ignorance. And, you know, he talked a lot about it, and he talked a lot around that statement. But what I really, really got out of it, I mean, I got a lot out of that statement, because this is a school, and we're here to learn. We're not here to make friends, although I like all of y'all. You support me when, you know, I'm feeling down. I got somebody to talk to. I have friends. I come from a far away place, Ohio, so I don't really know a lot of people. And, you know, I perceive that I have come into sup with some good quality people being in this school. But that's not what I'm here for. Right. And What Joe Williams used to say all of the time is, we are here to learn what thus saith Yahweh. That's why we're here. So that statement that Dr. Lamar Rhodes said, he's not going to make any excuses for our ignorance. I'm so glad to be here, because I learned something and I understand something. Come on over here. I understand something about that statement. This old boy got to be cast down and out, that ignorance. He's got to go. there ain't going to be no parts of them that goes over into the new earth state. So whatever ignorance that we have, it's got to go bye-bye. No excuses for the ignorance. We have an opportunity coming down into this school to learn something about the law of the spirit so that we can cast, so that Yahweh will cast down and out those theories, concepts, and opinions, the corruptible things that come with the morals that we have that are changeable. We need that carnal mind that we have to be cast down and out. That temporary carnal mind, it's got to go. Yahweh is not going to make any excuses for this old boy. He's not going to make any excuses for this old boy right here, Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons. Demon is just a perversion of an angel. That's all that it is a demon is just a perversion of an angel, and an angel is a ministering spirit. We've got all of these attributes, the nine divine attributes written up on the Moses chart, the migratory chart. And we say that there's other attributes, but those are the main principal attributes. But there's a multiplicity of attributes. And those angels minister to us. We all have a measure. Each and every one of these tabernacles that's walking around. We think, we come into this school and we think that we're somebody. Yeah. Yeah. We're learning. We're here to learn that that's not the case. We are Yahweh. We are spirit materialized. That's what matter is. Spirit materialized. Our bodies is made up of matter. We are derived from spirit. That's our origin. That's where we're going to go back to, whether you like it or not. This old boy in ignorance, his ignorance will be cast down. It will be no more. Moving on. So we're here to learn something about how we're made up. How we're drawn out of spirit. How we are, like another thing, what Chris was just saying it on Sunday, we are what we're looking for. Dr. Kinley, one of the recordings, the 45 recordings that just recently been released, he starts off in, you know, whatever his discourse that he's going into, and he's talking about when we go into prayer. I was talking to you about this. When we go into prayer, we tend, in the church world, at least, out in the world, we tend to ask God to come in and take control of the situation. Dr. Kinley said it like this. He said, I'm going to let you in on something. He was there before you got there. And he's there right now and going on. You can't get outside of Yahweh. But what we're here to do is to become aware of that, because this old boy's had us tricked thinking that we something other than Yahweh being made manifest. And it took a whole long, drawn out, you know, big to do to make something like that, you know, be understood. You've got the angels in heaven being created, and then there's a war being in heaven. It was funny. It was another thing that I think it was Dottie McNeil. I can't remember. She said something about a lot of people say they want to go to heaven. Mm-hmm. But they ain't realize there was a war in heaven. You would think about there being war in heaven. It might not be someplace you might want to be.
Second thought.
You might have some second thoughts about that. There's a war up there. There's a war in heaven. And we come to find out, we come to learn in this school. We're not here to, like I said, I'm just driving the nail in. We're not here to worship. We're here to learn. Right. We're here to come to an understanding. We're here to gain some knowledge so that there aren't any excuses. Romans 1:19 and 20. We don't want any excuses. Romans 1:19 and 20 was always, has always been like a theme song of this school. We go to this, and I mean, it's really good for what I'm talking about right now. And that's what they were talking about in Springfield today. And I really appreciate it. I got a lot out of it, so I hope you get something out of it too. Go ahead and read when you're ready.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them.
So we're here to learn. We've already said that. We want to, and now there's something that we can know about Yahweh, and it's manifest in them. How? Read.
For Yahweh has showed it unto them.
Stop. Yahweh showed it. Mm-hmm. Not me, not Nanette, not Samuel. Mm-hmm. Yahweh showed it. Absolutely. Nobody else. Whatever you can know about him, he showed it to him.
That's right.
There's another scripture I'm going to want you to get after this one, but we're going to finish reading this first, where it talks about those who diligently seek him. He's a rewarder of those. But go ahead and read, if somebody can find that for me. I don't know which one it is.
20. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
The invisible things. We were just talking about war in heaven. Heaven is a so-called invisible place. You can't see spirit to perceive spirit. So it's an invisible thing as far as the carnal mind, the fleshly mind, our physical bodies is concerned. We got five senses: sight, touch, taste, sound, and smell. That's all we got. We don't got spirit perceptors in a sense where we all are sitting in this room and we all see Michael Landon float across, you know, touched by an angel or something, float across. We're like, Yahweh shows himself in visions. Like, we got Moses out here. Here's an example of what I'm trying to talk about. Moses is out here after he fled out of Egypt into the wilderness of Sinai. He's 40 years out here in the wilderness. And he comes to the base of Mount Sinai, and he's tending to his father-in-law's flock of sheep. And he sees this bush that's burning, but it's not consumed. If anybody was standing next to him, no, they wouldn't have seen that. Because we don't got spirit receptors like that. Yahweh makes himself manifest in visions and revelations, and only to who he chooses.
Right.
We just, you know, and that's just the way that it is. And do you got that other scripture?
Hold it,
and then we finish up over here in Romans.
Okay, being understood by the things that are made.
So those invisible things, those spiritual things, those things of the spirit, those attributes of intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength. Though and the innumerable company of other attributes that are out there, those invisible things are understood. You can understand something about them by the things that are made. Mm-hmm. But don't forget that Yahweh showed it to you.
Right.
Don't forget that part. We done moved on from 19 over into 20, and we done forgot the Yahweh and the show. I know I did for a long time. I can't speak for you. But for a long time, I moved from 19, Yahweh showed it to me, and then I moved on to something that I can know. And I done got on my own, something that I done picked up with my infinitesimal wisdom. Because, I mean, what is this intelligence that, you know, that I may have picked up have in comparison to eternal intelligence. Like intelligence that has no beginning or no ending. My intelligence, this physical body, I could argue started in 1980 when I was conceived by my parents, but I wasn't born until 1981. So I mean, I was born in September, so it's probably like right around, this is 1981, January, something like that. You know, it's January, December, somewhere around that area. I could argue that that's where my intelligence started. This intelligence is eternal.
Got your point.
Got no beginning. You can't, we say in this school, you can't. It's incomprehensible. This Yahweh in his pure spirit state is incomprehensible and inscrutable. I'm sorry, but you just can't get to the end of eternity to comprehend how big that is.
No, you can't. That's right. This,
I mean, you can think, wow, that's really, really big. You can understand what the word eternal means, but you cannot comprehend I don't even know the word.
Me either.
Gigantic, I'll just say.
Vast.
Yes, that's even better. Vast. That's huge. You know, and we want to know something about him. Go ahead and get that Hebrews.
Okay. Hebrews 11:6. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to Yahweh must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him.
It was talking a lot about faith in the scripture lesson
Hebrews?
Today in James. We was talking, there was a lot of talk of faith and faith with or without works.
Right.
And, you know, when you read that, I believe that it's not too difficult to get kind of confused when it's talking about faith without works and, you know, faith with works. And
yeah, at first I was, yeah.
Yeah, well, and seeking Yahweh is a work. Now, that's a different type of work than going out handing out turkeys on Thanksgiving.
Yeah, true that.
Or flipping out $5 at the off ramp to the, you know, vagabond, drunk, whatever, indigent person that's begging for money. You know, running a children's ministry. You know, they got a lot of those where the people go out and they bring the children together and they put together activities and games for the kids to keep them off the streets in low income areas, and you know, and also for those who got people working, and you know, they just, parents are just working all of the time, so they want to get them involved in being around with people, kind of like what I was talking about, how we not here to make friends. Well, these children's ministries, they're put together so that the kids can have some friends, and you know, they're not really learning much besides social constructs,
right,
and what have you. Mm-hmm. And they put Lord in there a little bit here, Bible verse over here a little bit or there, and then they want to tell you, oh, yeah, this is the children's ministry, and It's really just something carnal. They're just priming these children to be members of the church, actively donating into the fund.
Righteousness.
Yeah, their righteousness here on earth. That's a very good point. And you know, we have a work that we do, and our work is just learning of him. What's the other one? Take my yoke upon me. Let's get that real quick, because that's where I want to go. That's where my train of thought is at right now. Matthew 11.
20, you want me to do 28 or 29?
Yeah, you can pick it up. We're at the beginning of the thought.
In Matthew 11:28.
Mm-hmm.
Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest.
Come unto Yahshua. Come unto him. Hold that, and then give me what we had in the scripture lesson, John 14 and 6. And he's talking to his disciples, and he tells them about himself right here. Read that.
John 14, 6.
Mm-hmm.
Yahshua said unto him,
mm-hmm.
I am the way. The truth and the life.
I am the way, the truth, and the life. Hey, who are you, Yahshua? I'm the way. I'm the truth, and I'm the life.
Right.
If that was like he came in and it was about to be a boxing match or something like that, he came in. Yeah, now introducing the way, the truth. Okay, I'm being corny. but that's who he is. He is the way, and he's the truth, and he's the life. So we want to come unto the way. We want to come unto the truth. We want to come unto the way to our Heavenly Father. Why is he the way unto our Heavenly Father? John 5 and 39.
John 5:39.
Mm-hmm.
Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life.
You search around through them scriptures. Now, we know that them scriptures wasn't Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the Acts of the Apostles, Romans, or Revelations, or none of that. That hadn't even, the way the founder said it, he said it ain't even been a bit of pen scratch of that written at the time that he said that. Mm-hmm. The scriptures at that time was the law and the prophets. We could go to Isaiah 8 and 20, but I'm not, because I'm going to have you just jumping around. But it says right there, to the law, to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, then there's no light in them. And he's saying right here that ye search the scriptures, read.
For ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life.
They think, you searching around, you think that's how you're going to get some eternal life. But wrong, read.
And they are they which testify of me.
They are they which testify of Yahshua.
Right.
Making him the way.
Right.
Now let's get back over there where we were talking about Matthew 11. Yeah.
29. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me.
Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. Now when an ox has a yoke on, that's the burden. That's the burden that they had. They carry it around to till the fields, whatever. That's what they do. They work with. Now, when we talking about works, we were just talking about works,
right?
And faith with works and without works. He's telling you what the work is right here.
That's right.
Go ahead and read.
Take my yoke upon you and learn of me.
Learn. That's why A man by the name of Henry Clifford Kinley started a school and not a church. When he started his school, people wanted to know why they called it the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. They wanted to know. I mean, first had it like they had a Kinley Institute or something like that before it took on its final, the name that we have right now was like the Kinley Institute, but it was always a school. I could be wrong. Somebody could call me, correcting me about the original name. It doesn't matter. That's not the name right now. That name was changed, and it was changed to the name that it is right now. And listening to these recordings, Dr. Kinley said, people came up to him and said, why you don't call it a church so that we can know what it is? But they couldn't get it. They couldn't understand nothing about this school with the title. The Institute. It's an institute. An institute is an organization, a learning organization of divine. It's divine, heavenly things.
Right.
Righteous things, divine things. You ever had a piece of cake and it's just the best piece of cake? And you say, oh, that is divine. It's just, there ain't nothing wrong with the cake. It's all right. All the ingredients are all in the right place.
Perfect. Right.
That old boy missed that old boy, the devil. He's a perversion. He's a nasty cake. Fruit cake. You might like fruit cake. I don't like fruit cake. Divine, metaphysical, meta, meaning beyond, physical, meaning beyond the physical. We just read Romans 1:19-20 talking about how the invisible things from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. And that's what we're here for. I'm just driving that point home. I'm just driving that. Because that's where I'm at right now. That's what's on my heart and mind,
right,
from the things that I was listening to earlier when I was in Springfield. And Dr. Rhodes said, quoted Dr. Kinley, where Dr. Kinley said, Yahweh's not going to make any excuses for your ignorance. And I meditated on that because Dr. Kinley told us to meditate on these things, these important things. In the introduction, which somebody even quoted earlier in class, he says it's important for us to stop and think intelligently before rendering a decision, affirmatively or negatively. And I'm not saying it exactly the same way. It's important to just stop. If you don't got the answer, you better stop. Because you just keep on running with this old boy and you be in a world of hurt. Mm-hmm. And then in more intelligent words, that's what he said in the introduction. That sometimes stopping and thinking for a minute will relieve us of a lot of pain and suffering and what have you.
Yeah, that's true.
So we want people to learn. I want to learn. I don't know about y'all. I want to learn. I've been so grateful to have a place that I can go to learn something about what thus saith Yahweh. And it'd only be a few of us up in here. Mm-hmm. It'd be a little, I mean, we got a lot of chairs and little people. Mm-hmm. and you know what?
It's okay.
That's all right.
It's okay. Mm-hmm. That's for sure.
The understanding that I have about my Heavenly Father Yahweh is still being increased. Because guess what? This is just because a couple of little people in here. And we already talked about ain't none of y'all doing the teaching anyway.
That's right.
It's Yahweh that's doing the teaching. He's the one who makes it manifest. Where two or more in his gather in his name, there he will be also.
That's right. Absolutely.
Let's keep on reading. Take my yoke upon you, dear.
Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, mm-hmm. for I am gentle and lowly in heart, mm-hmm. and ye shall find rest unto your souls.
You're going to find rest unto your souls. Correct. You learn of Yahshua. Because you learn of Yahshua, then you learn in the Yahweh. We was just talking about he's the way. You find rest. He's the way. You get you working. See, Moses was called up here in his mount. And Exodus, the 24th chapter, he was called up here into the mount. And the glory of Yahweh abode upon the mount 6 days. And then on that seventh day, when you go over there into Genesis 1 and 1, Moses' vision, it shows the creation. He talks about what he sees in the vision and the earth being without form and void all the way on out to the sixth day of the creation. And then on the seventh day, Yahweh rested. We got to rest too. He didn't show them what he needed to know, and he rested. The invisible things that only Moses seen. None of these, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and the 70 elders, none of them seen all of this. We got this line drawn up all like this, showing them looking up. But they seen Yahweh down here. Moses was down here when they seen Yahweh Elohim. It wasn't until he was called up, he went up out of their sight. They were told to stay down here. And him and his minister Joshua, see, we look at this chart. And we get to start thinking that Moses was chilling up here on the top of the mount, and Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and the 70 elders, they were all looking at it at the same time. But when you read it, let's go ahead and do it. Let's go ahead and get over in the 24th chapter and just read that. I just want to show this because we got this chart here, and I mean, it's got to be like this so that you can draw out the principle of what's going on. But we want to get down into the details and actually know what was actually happening. It all wasn't happening at the same time, even though it was. Time and space for us is different than time and space for Yahweh. We got over in Genesis 2 and 4. It tell you about that. But let's get over in Exodus.
Exodus 24 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
And he said unto Moses, come up unto Yahweh, thou and Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, mm-hmm. and 70 of the elders of Israel,
right.
and worship ye afar off.
So we got this whole mountain right here. And Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and the 70 elders worshiping Yahweh afar off. That's why you see down, you got the base of this mount right here, and you got them down here afar off. They little. Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu a little bit bigger, whoever the artist was. They did a good job with that. And then you got Moses up here. He up here in the top of the mount with Yahweh Elohim, worshiping. They worshiping afar off. Go ahead and read.
And Moses alone shall come near Yahweh.
Moses alone shall come near Yahweh. Read.
But they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people go up with them.
Neither shall none of the other people go up. It's only these 74 total that were invited up here into this mount to witness this great sight. Now, let's go ahead and skip down to where they all seen.
9.
Mm-hmm.
Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel.
So they came down. So they started down at the bottom of the mount, and they went up all together. We got they static on here because we can't move them around. We don't got no slide thing to bring Moses down here with them. But at this time, in 9, they're all together. Read.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel.
They went up. Now, they didn't go all the way up into the mountain and then come back down. Then when they were together, they saw the Elohim. Read.
And there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone.
Mm-hmm.
And as it were, the body of heaven in its clearness.
As it were, the body of heaven in its clearness. And then it kind of looked like the earth. When we, you know, this was written way before the race to space, before science allowed us to get into a rocket and look at the earth from afar off. And it was a phenomenal thing once technology allowed us to get up and see what the earth looks like. And we got plenty of pictures everywhere all over the place of what the earth looks like now, because we got satellites constantly taking pictures, constantly getting views of the earth right now. And it looks like a paved work, a sapphire stone. And then before there was a rocket. Yeah, they was out here with sandals on and wearing like robes and stuff like that, and riding horse and carriages, you know. I mean, the principle of transportation was there with the horse and carriages and the yokes of the oxen and whatnot doing the work for you. But it was manual. It was all manual, and the beasts of the field did the work, the hard work for us. We didn't have the contraptions, you know, to cause flight. We didn't have the grasp of fossil fuels at the time and combustion engines and things of the sort like that. So they saw the earth. They got to see what the space racers got to see way before. Ain't that something? That's beautiful. Go ahead and read.
And upon the noble of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand.
So he got hands and he got feet. He looked something like a man. Read.
Also, they saw Elohim and did eat and drink. And Yahweh said unto Moses.
So he must have a mouth. He's saying stuff. They eating and drinking. He got hands. He got feet. Likeness and image of a man to me. Go ahead, read.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, come up to me into the mount and be there.
What? He said unto Moses, come up into the mount. So he not up here just yet. That's all I wanted to get to. Go ahead and read it. Just read it through.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, come up to me mm-hmm. into the mount and mm-hmm. be there. And I will give thee tables of stone and a law and commandments which I have written that thou teachest them. And Moses rose up and his minister Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain, Mount of Elohim.
Now Moses went up alone. Or did he go up with somebody? He went up alone and by himself, because the person who told him to go up there alone in the first place was his minister, Joshua, or Yahshua, or Yehoshua. That's who told him to go up there. Mm-hmm. And he was up, he was with all of the, you might as well say 75 now. We got Joshua. We got 70 elders, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, Moses, and Joshua. Mm-hmm. All going up. And they up here nigh, and they saw Yahweh. They saw Yahweh Elohim. Mm-hmm. And then when they seen Yahweh in his glorious state, in a vision, they seen a vision. And this little white line right here is just a depiction that these folks had a vision.
Right.
It didn't look like this, even though all across the Institute, most of these charts are drawn out in the same configuration. We don't want you to get stuck on this, because that's idolatry. We get stuck on the way that these charts look, and depending on these charts, That is idolatry. They was at the principle was a mountain, Mount Sinai. Go on Google Earth and find it. It looked like that, something like it. After some couple thousand years of erosion take place in volcanic activity and what have you, something like that. It didn't look like this though. And we were in the first trip, we were told not to make any graven images worshiping Yahweh. So that these charts ain't for no worship. I had to get myself straight, because I had this idea. I had to get straightened out myself. I had this idea that I wanted to put one of these charts on the back windshield. Like have it printed out and put on the back windshield of my car. And, I thought it was a good thought. Mm-hmm. And you know, it hadn't taken place. And then going on, you know, as I'm thinking about it, and it's on my mind. And then I hear a quote from Dr. Kinley, you know, talking about him having guards, security around him. He said the security ain't for him.
Right.
It's for y'all.
Right.
Because there's people who come in and they trying to take his life, because they been told, he done told the truth on them.
Yep.
He done exposed they back. They dirty laundry. Yeah, they try to get at him, and they'll go through you to get at him.
They sure will. Yeah.
So that's what he had some guards for. And he said something about, you know, you go out here wearing stuff and all of that with the names on it and everything like that. Why you want to put a target on yourself for the devil to get you? Mm-hmm. He know exactly, because he know.
Yeah, he do.
Doc said he was raising up both mysteries right in the same room. And that beast was more subtle than any beast of the field. He was the most subtle. He get right in there. You and I, we was just talking about narcissists earlier. They look good. I've been talking about narcissists a lot. I know. They look good. They get in, they just seem like a normal person. And you get to know them. You get close to them, and you try to please them, and you hope that they'll please you in return, but it just don't happen. You might get something, but you don't get what you really want from out of them. You get what they'll give you, and that's all that they give you. And they don't have the ability to give you, to reciprocate what you've been given. You know, you got that whole, the whole thing people are raised by, to do unto others as you would be done unto yourself. Well, when you're dealing with a narcissist, you a dang on fool if you go keep on. I mean, you could go for so long, but you have to have some discernment. And come to a point where you recognize and realize that this person is wasting my time. This is all about them. And that's what happens when we got people down here in this school. It's all about them. It's not about them learning the Yahweh, learning the Yahshua. They just worried about saving their own souls. They worried about saving their own souls, but they ain't thinking about the Father. They don't got no love for the Father because they don't know him. There's a scripture in there that says, haven't we preached in your name? It said, I don't, get away from me. I don't know you. It's people who are preaching in the name of Yahweh. And perverting the true gospel. They have no idea what the true gospel is. What is that? Marlon like said, moreover, brethren, what is that? Is that Colossians or is that Corinthians? Dr. Marlon, where are you there? What's that one where it's more that I preach no. the true gospel?
First Corinthians 15.
Can we get that real quick? Yeah. Thank you. I don't know if I'm getting into this textbook.
1 Corinthians 15:1. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received.
It's just raw drawn out right here. This is the gospel. This is telling you right here what the gospel is. And there's people out here who preaching using the names Yahweh, Elohim, Yahshua, or Yeshua, however they want to try to pronounce it, and they're not preaching the gospel. Go ahead and whenever you're ready, go ahead and read.
By which also ye are saved.
You saved by this gospel. Sorry, I was loud. Read.
If ye keep in memory what I've preached unto you.
If you keep in memory. Read.
Unless ye have believed in vain.
Unless you believed in emptiness. You taking this and this for yourself. You want to keep it for yourself. You want to keep your little pennies, your little stockpile together. You don't want to share with the brethren. You don't have no intentions of really giving nothing back. You just got to get yours. Emptiness. That it don't work that way. What are we talking about? Faith without works. When you got faith, you got some works. Yeah. I was told when I came into this school, probably first or second time that I came down into this school, that if I stay in this school, then I it'll get to a point where I start talking to somebody and I'll know the spirit that's operating in them. I know what's being manifest out coming from that tabernacle, that vessel. Because you know if they have a love for the brethren. It says right there, it's in the book. It says to have the Holy Spirit is to have a love for the brethren. You're going to work, you're going to lay down your life for them, just like he laid down his life for us.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Just like he laid down his life for her.
That's right.
Go ahead and read. Mm-hmm.
For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received, how that Yahshua died for our sins according to the scriptures.
How he laid down his life for our sins, which a sin is a transgression of the law. There was a law in place here that was given to the Jews and the Jews only, 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances. And we just read it over there in James in 10. It says, him who does the law, you got that? James 10, be a debtor to whole 2 and 10.
James 10.
Just hold where we at, but we're coming right back to that.
Where we at 2:10?
Yes, please.
For whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all.
Yeah, whosoever keep it, wait, just hold it right there. Whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point.
Right.
Out of this, you got 612 of them down, but you done messed up on 13. Read.
And yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all.
He's guilty of the whole thing. That's why it necessitated Yahshua. Go ahead, keep on reading.
For he that said, do not commit adultery, said also, do not commit murder.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if thou commit no adultery, yet if thou commit murder, thou art become a transgressor of the law.
All right. There's the point right there.
There you go.
Now, we can go back over there into Corinthians. We don't want, see, We don't want to miss this, that it necessitated salvation to come in, to take this law out of the way and usher in a new covenant. This is what the preaching of the gospel is all about. This is what's being preached over here. This is what's being talked about, is what the gospel is. How he died. Mm-hmm. Why did he die? How did he die? Who was he? When was it? All of these things are important. We just talked about learning to him.
Right.
So we know some of these things, then you know about them. You know? If you know me, then you know where I was born at. You know, well, you might know what school I went to. You might know my parents' name. You might know when I came to California. Mm-hmm. You're going to know these things. You know, that's you learning to me.
Right.
I ain't important.
Good example. That's good.
He said learn to him. Mm-hmm. Go ahead and get back over in Corinthians, the gospel.
4, and that he was buried and he rose again the third day according to the scriptures.
That's so beautiful. He died and was buried and rose again on a phenomenal third day according to the scriptures. We just had John 5:39 read. Mm-hmm. He said, ye search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. Well, this is what he's talking about over here, that what he did was according to the scriptures. Now give me 5:17, John 5:17.
John 5:17.
Mm-hmm.
But
does that think not? I messed up.
No.
17:3. Think not that I am come.
Oh, Matthew 5:17.
Matthew 5:17. Yeah. This ain't no Bible quoting, scripture toting class. You know, it occurred to me. I was listening to another one of the lectures from Dr. Kinley. I had no idea, you know, just because it just doesn't occur to us that the chapters and the verses that are in the Bible, well, they weren't always there.
Right.
Like, they weren't, that was an invention.
Yep, that's right.
To make it easier for somebody to find, to categorize and find the things that are written, mm-hmm. You know, and whatever. That's just a useless fact according to what I'm talking about right now. Let's
Matthew 5:17.
Yes, please. Thank you.
Think not that I am come to destroy the law.
He didn't come to
prophets.
Destroy that 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances that were out there for the Jews and the Jews only.
Right.
Not for the Gentiles. Not right. For me. Not for Samuel, not for Bud, for anybody in this room. We ain't got no Jews in here. We got one down in Oceanside, Dr. Bruce Geller. Mm-hmm. He was a descendant of the Jews, so it would be for him. He couldn't keep it. He admitted that he couldn't keep it himself.
Right. Yeah, I was going to say, yeah, he did.
He'll be the first one to tell you. But think not, read.
Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. Mm-hmm. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
You're not come to destroy it. When you destroy something, you just tear it up. You got a letter or something that you done wrote to somebody, and you destroy that letter. You light some fire to it. It's no longer. It doesn't even exist anymore. He didn't come to destroy it. He came to fulfill it. And we know, everybody in this room have been here enough times. If you ain't never heard nothing about this teaching before, and you out there in Zoom or YouTube, most likely YouTube, and you listening to this, go ahead and look up the definition of fulfill for yourself. Right. To fulfill is to accomplish. Mm-hmm. It's to complete.
Right.
Right.
When you get a car loan and you fulfill the payment, this is what Will Williams used to say all the time. When you fulfill the payments on the car loan, they had you the title. And you ain't got to make no more payments.
Right.
It's done. Yep. But you still get to keep the car. You got the car.
You fulfilled it.
Think about that. You reap the benefits. It was said if they could follow this law, it would be unto their righteousness, and they couldn't, so it necessitated Yahweh himself to do it. Because Israel was the bride. That's the covenant that they made. They said, all this that thou sayest, we will do. We got to think about this thing. They did have the good. They had good intentions to do it, but good intentions paved the road to hell.
The churches do too.
The churches got a good intention too. Mm-hmm. These people, these pastors, these Joel Osteen. I'm sure he likes all of the money that he's getting, but I'm sure that he really thinks that he's doing something good for the people. Mm-hmm. And he sees the benefits of it. He sees the benefits of what he does with the people around him. They get nicer cars. They come from, you know, destitution. And they, you know, they're raised up in this world. But what profited a man to gain the whole world?
That's right.
And to lose his soul? Because it's them same people, them Joel Steens, them the guy with the gap teeth like me. What's his name? The black guy. I don't know his name. T.D. Jakes. T.D. Jakes, all of them same people, Billy Graham and all of that, they same congregations, I was about to say a cuss word, scared to dickens when they in the hospital bed about to take off the flesh. They don't know what's going to happen because they didn't learn.
Right.
He said, take on my yoke, all you that are heavy laden and burdened. Learn of him. Mm-hmm. That don't mean learn. See, what they got messed up is they think the word is the Bible.
Right.
It's the book. It's not the book. John 1:1 said, in the beginning was the word. And the word was with Yahweh, and the word was Yahweh. So there's a typewriter, freaking scribes back there. In the beginning, the first thing before I create this creation, I'm going to give me some paper. I'm gonna float around in the book, flying in the sky, reading rainbow. All right. Gordy, we got, where are we at?
18.
All right.
For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, mm-hmm. one yod of the smallest part of a letter shall in no wise pass from the law. Till all be fulfilled.
This law is not going away. This law couldn't go away until it was fulfilled, until it was completed, until it was brought to an end. Yahweh is the way. We want to learn the truth about that. We're reading over here in Corinthians about what the gospel is, the truth of what the gospel is. It said it would be under your salvation. It said the gospel, the preaching of the gospel would be your under your salvation, which is equivalent to life. It'll save your soul because you done learned about him and who he is. Why is that significant? We have a law. And in that law is a tabernacle that they offered up their sacrifices to when they broke the law. This was their schoolmaster, this tabernacle that was out here. And it was said over, it was written over there in Exodus in 25 and 8, I think it is, if you got that. He says, see that you make everything. And that's what we do down here in this school, is we see to it that everything is made. Go ahead and read it if you got it.
Exodus 25:8.
Mm-hmm.
And let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them.
That he may dwell among them.
According to all that I show thee after the pattern of the tabernacle.
According to all. Just like according. Go ahead. Let's not skip over that word according. Can you get me up there in the dictionary of the definition of according? Webster's, I don't want Google. Google be letting me down sometimes. Except in my house, it be turning the lights on and off and stuff. Air conditioner, that's always good. But Webster's, we see.
To grant or give, especially as appropriate, due, or earned. To bring into agreement.
Bringing into agreement. Read. Anymore?
To be consistent or in harmony.
Consistent. In harmony. He said, make a pattern consistent with everything that he showed him. Not just the, see, he was up in his mouth for 40 days, right? And he showed him the 6 days of the creation, and then he showed him for 33 days the construction of the tabernacle. But what he showed him first, the days of the creation. Mm-hmm. And it didn't take him 6 solar days to create. He drew it out in 6 solar days for Moses to understand and comprehend. Like I was talking about my drawing up mine. Mm-hmm. I can't pick up the. Dr. Kinley had a stupendous vision and revelation. I can't even imagine. Like. The brevity of what he's seen. For him to get all of this in a day. But we got it. We got over in Genesis 2 and 4. If you read that, because we talk about this 6 days of the creation of where Moses was up here, but let's read that. It might be something different. It's different in the King James or the Holy Name.
You say 2 and 4? Mm-hmm. And Yahweh Elohim formed.
This is the
man?
Origins.
Huh? Oh, okay. 1. These are the origins of the heavens and of the earth when they were created in the
day. Say that again.
In the day.
That's one day.
Right.
That's just one day. The heavens, these are the origins of the heavens and the earth when they were created in the day. Read.
Right. That Yahweh Elohim made the earth and the heavens.
In the day that Yahweh Elohim made the earth and the heavens. Mm-hmm. That's just one day. And we got over in the first chapter where you got 6 days or 7 days with the day that he rested, including the day that he rested. But all of this has happened for Yahweh all in one day. That's why we got over here on this ages and dispensations chart, which I used to be scared of this chart. I was frightened of this chart because it's all of these words. There's no pictorial illustrations on it. I had these lines and stuff. I was like, man, don't get me on this chart over here because I don't know. Yahweh, coming into this school and sitting down. See, what Doc asked, he didn't ask nobody to pay no tithes. He didn't ask nobody to pay for anything. You know, then he didn't ask nobody to pay the light bill and all of that stuff. I mean, yeah, it's got to get paid. Somebody's going to do it. If you want to have a place to go, these bills are going to have to get paid. Or we're going to have to do it out of our houses. You know, I mean, if we want the luxuries of having a classroom like this, then the stuff's got to get paid. Right. So somebody going to pay for this one way or the other, or we're not going to have this.
Right.
We'll make do with what we have, though. What we do have. If we got to do it out in the park and set it up on stands, go to someplace free, then we'll do it there. But What he did ask is for us to pay attention. Show up on time and pay attention. Now, I know I got it bad with the on-time thing. I get here on time, but we can't get started on time for the life of me. I'm sorry. I'm working on it. I know that it's something, but I'm not going to get into that right now. What I came over to this chart is because we've got the whole creation on a timetable drawn out in the day of eternity. This fiery cloud all around the edge of this chart, just like on the other one that we got over there, it symbolizes eternity. And eternity is just one. Just like Yahweh, the unity of the Spirit. What is that? In Genesis 2 and 6, Yahweh is a unity. What is
Deuteronomy 6. Deuteronomy 6 and 4.
Deuteronomy 6 and 4. Thank you. Read that.
Hear, O Israel, Yahweh our Elohim is Yahweh a unity.
Yahweh our Elohim is Yahweh a unity. All of this is wrapped up into one. Because in eternity, it's all together. We got this concept that there's something separate because we got a chart here and 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 so on and so forth, that there's something separate. There's some separation going on. But Yahweh is a unity. He just breaking down having these different charts, how the manifestation changes. But we go forth in this school to show you and prove that everything is 1, 2, 3. Absolutely everything in the universe, down to the fine particulates of matter that we were talking about, the atom, which is derived from spirit. Everything is threefold. Mm-hmm. Proton, neutron, and electron. Cell, nucleus, nucleolus, and cell body. Mm-hmm. Head cavity, chest cavity, and abdominal cavity. And then it might be a good time right now to go overhead. And I had this pamphlet picked up. We just go ahead and try to pick this up if we can. Read a little bit. We got about 25 minutes left, and see what this pamphlet has to say. Did you? Okay. Well, you can get his. Your physical body is a witness, or your physical body a witness to the name of Yahweh. Bring it. Your physical body, a witness to the name of Yahweh. Do you need a pamphlet? Do you need it? You got it? All right, I can pull mine up here on my phone. So.
Oh, you got it like that, huh?
Let me see here.
That's cool.
Just give me a second. We're going to skip all of the past five in, and we're going to get to the page one on there. If you give me a second to find it here. I had it pulled up earlier on my... I abandoned that because I was...
Do we have a date of this?
It might be in the front page, inside the front page.
No, it's not.
Nothing on there?
Mm-mm. Well, not on the copy.
Maybe
so.
The last
year.
Huh?
Maybe the last
year.
Good idea.
Yeah. I don't see no date on there. I don't see no date on it, but it says it was composed and compiled by Dr. Kinley. Mm-hmm. Let me see here. So, yeah, if we go ahead and skip to page one, I'll just have you go ahead and start reading when you're ready. Yes.
The true Hebrew name.
No. That's the introduction.
Oh, you're talking
skip,
about.
Yeah, past five.
Oh, your physical body.
Yeah.
Your physical body, a witness to the name of Yahweh. While as yet there is much debate and controversy among the ranks of the unlearned and ignorant masses, those who have conducted a thorough research and investigation know that the name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh and not God or Lord, which are only titles and not names.
See, there's that research and investigation. Go ahead and read.
Nor Jehovah, which is erroneous and impossible. But it must have been in the mind of an infinitely intelligent and all-wise Heavenly Father who demands that we, his creatures, not blaspheme his holy name or take it in vain.
Infinitely intelligent. That's like eternal. Go ahead. We got Exodus 20 and 7. Maybe I can.
Here it is.
I can help with some of these as we go along.
Exodus 20 and 7.
Mm-hmm.
Thou shalt not take away the name of Yahweh thy Elohim to bring it to naught. For Yahweh will not hold him guiltless that taketh away his name to bring it to naught.
Now, that's in the Holy Name Bible, but also in the King James Version, it says, "Y'all shall not take that name in vain." And okay. We know that we already talked about that name being in vain, meaning useless, meaningless, taking away that name and substituting it for a title. Because we know over in England, the House of the Lords, and your landlord, if you don't own your property, he got a name. You're not going to write out that check to landlord. You write out the check to landlord, he's going to think you've been smoking something. He might think you might not be suitable to live on the property that he has given to you. If you write out the check to him in landlord, you're going to need to give it to him in his name.
Right.
Whatever that may be. And that's a title. And you're taking it away. You're bringing it to naught by using that. Adonai is the same thing. You're taking his name away. And Jehovah is just erroneous.
Erroneous, yeah.
That's just an erroneous substitution for the name. Because there can't be no letter J. There is no letter J in the Hebrew, Greek, or Latin language. Now, we know that's something that's significant. Because we got over here on when the Messiah was put up on the cross, Pilate wrote in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. So that just takes it all out of your mind. What language that they was writing these things in? What they could have possibly been writing? Whatever it is that they were writing at that time, Hebrew, Greek, and Latin were the languages that were being used. That's the languages that were being used when the Messiah was hung up on the cross. Yeah, those were the common languages, correct. Mm-hmm. Those were the specific languages that were being used. All the people who gathered around and watched the Messiah get slain up here on the cross, die up here on the cross, were either speaking Hebrew, Greek, or Latin. If they spoke something else, it wasn't significant enough of them for it to be written up there in those languages. So that's an important thing. And we're here to learn. We want to get into the finer details of what we're learning about when we're learning of our Messiah and why he got up there on that cross. Fulfilling this law according to the scriptures, as he said.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead and read.
not blaspheme his holy name or take it in vain, that most of us would be too mentally lazy and unconcerned to make an exhaustive research, so that he must have provided an easier and plainer or more simple way for us to know that his name is Yahweh.
Now, ain't that something? We already was talking. I didn't read this before. I did not read this before. I had opened it up earlier today, before I had even, like, I was just looking at it. I was like, maybe we'll go through a pamphlet tonight, because that's what we do.
Let's go.
And I don't know if we'll get to it. I really didn't know he was going to get to it. But I was just talking about how Doc used to say he was going to raise up both mysteries right in the same room. He telling us how. Because we too dang on lazy to do the investigation. He said, take on my yoke. My burden is light. You learn of me. Well, if you too lazy to learn of him, then you perverting the truth. Mm-hmm. This is simple. Very simple thing. Go ahead. You get a mic. Here. You ain't got to go over there.
Jeremiah 23:27 even points out that how the people were caused to forget his name even.
Yeah.
So how important, yes.
26. How long shall this be in the heart of the prophets that prophesies lies? Yea, they are prophets of the deceit of their own heart, which think to cause my people to forget my name by their dreams, which they tell every man to his neighbor, as their fathers have forgotten my name for Baal.
They had Martin Luther King had a dream.
You did? Yeah.
We got dreams that, you know, people, I know I used to have a dream of peace on earth before I came into this school. I dreamed about, you know, I wish it was a day that we wasn't at war with the Middle East or Asia, or, you know, whites against blacks, or whatever it may be, you know, people, like we was talking about in the scripture, we was talking about in the scripture lesson, you know, poor people against rich people, all of those different disparities that we had. Before I came into this school, I thought that was a dream. But what y'all, that's what said, I ain't come to bring peace but war. Mm. He dividing mother from father, brother from daughter, and father from son, tearing families apart. And you can see that here down here when you come into this school and you learn something about this true name of Yahshua. And dang, I just lost that. Maybe I can find it. But when you come up and you find something about this true name, and you don't keep it to yourself, you go tell somebody about it. I don't want to hear none of Yahoo. Mm-hmm. I mean, oh yeah, the Tetragrammaton. We use the Lord out of respect for the Hebrews, because they thought that the name was revered. Well, we use Jesus because that's the most common. Like Samuel was saying with the common languages, that's what they try to do. They try to take that and say, we're going to use Jesus because this is the common language that we got now. Well, Samuel only allows us to call him Samuel because he's been in the United States so long that people have been perverting his name that he knows what they mean when they call him Samuel. Mm-hmm. His name is Samuel. He's got experience with Samuel. It's spelled the same way, so if you put it, write a check to Samuel or Samuel, you're gonna, he gonna be able to cash it. So it's, you know, no harm, no foul there. But that's not your name. It's Samuel. Samuel. My daughter's name is R-E-L, like R-E-L, but spelled like the Little Mermaid. So people call her Ariel all the time. And I'm telling her, I'm teaching her that as you grow, you're going to know if somebody knows you or not by the way they say your name. Mm-hmm. That's why I chose that name for her. She might be in a, on a sports team or something. Her name be on a roster. Somebody go reach out to her and boom. She going to know that she don't know that person. That person don't know me because my name is Ariel. I'm getting off. Thank you. Let's get back onto the
pamphlet.
Onto the pamphlet. Yeah. We, his name is important. Read.
This pamphlet is written for the express purpose of showing to all who read it that Yahweh has put the undeniable and incontestable proof that the true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh right within and upon each of our physical bodies in plain view of ourselves and everyone else.
Ain't that the invisible things for the creation being explained by the things that are made? Go ahead and read.
And therefore, we have no excuse for not knowing his true name. And when we vehemently argue and stubbornly swear by the so-called names, God or Lord, or by the name Jehovah.
I didn't read this before.
And Jesus Christ, we are openly displaying our profound ignorance and colossal stupidity to the whole world.
And that's what they do. That's exactly what happens when you come into this school and you find out these names and you go to somebody and you start telling them about, man, I found out that there was no letter J in the English language until some 1400 years. And the reason why, it was because there was two I's put next to each other and it formed a sound after it got the little hook on it. They put the little hook on it to make it a J so that it signified two I's being next to each other because it's less of a brush stroke to put the hook on one I. It looks like an eye with a hook on it.
Yep.
And when you tell somebody about that, and then you tell them that the J came out, the sound of it came out later on, and then when you tell them that there is, I'm not going to walk over there, there is to this day no letter J.
Right.
In the Hebrew language for which Yahshua was a Hebrew. And then go on further to say, scratch out Hebrew, scratch out Greek, and scratch out Latin. Mm-hmm. Scratch them all out. Ain't no J there. Mm-hmm. So how's it going to be a J? How's it going to be a Jehovah? How's it going to be a Jesus? Mm-hmm. Samuel ought to appreciate that a little bit because I'm sure it came a point in time when people started calling him Samuel, and he was a little confused. Am I right? Like, why you keep calling me Samuel? My name's Samuel. I still do it. I'm guilty of it time to time. But, you know, and I try. I try to be aware of that a little bit more to call people by their name. Like, I was calling Bud Wunsch. But it's Wunsch. Wunsch. Right? Am I doing it right? What?
Rhyme it with lunch.
Wunsch. Wunsch. Whatever. I'm trying. I'm going to have to talk to him about class after class about his name again. It's a difficult name to pronounce. But it's important to him. Hudgeonwardle.
Try that one.
Man. I don't even blame nobody. I just make a joke out of it. But it's still important. Go ahead and read about our colossal stupidity and ignorance.
Okay, I don't. Marlon sent something about consider reading Psalms 83:16.
Okay, well, pop it up. Let's get it.
Read out of King James first.
Yeah, right. Fill their faces with shame that they may see the name, O Lord. Okay.
Who translated?
O Yahweh. Let them
no,
be.
Just read it in King James as it is.
Okay.
We read it afterwards.
All right. Let them be confounded and troubled forever. Yea, let them be put to shame and perish. That men may know that thou, whose name alone is Jehovah, art the most high over all the earth.
Mm. Now, can we read it out of the Holy Name Bible?
Yep. That one.
No, that's good. That's a good one.
83:16, mm-hmm. Holy Name. Fill their faces with shame, that they may seek thy name, O Yahweh. Let them be confounded and troubled forever. Yea, let them be put to shame and perish. The men may know that thou, whose name alone is Yahweh, art the most high over all the earth.
Yeah, I mean, those out there that taking that name in vain, they're confounded. And yeah, it's just like the same thing. This is just the same thing that we was talking about with Moses out here at the burning bush. If anybody would have been sitting next to him, they wouldn't have seen it. They would have been confounded. Is what he talking about? He tripping. Mm-hmm. Did he get the magic mushrooms or something jumping off or whatever? Like they wouldn't know. They would be confounded as to why he was talking. As you might think to himself, if he even was expressing anything, or just could have possibly been there in a trance. And many times in the scriptures, you know, he was told to put off his shoes, so he took off his shoes, so he was still upright. Many times when the word of Yahweh comes to people, they fall down to their face. He puts them down. This particular time, he got the opportunity to stay upright. And Moses went to and spoke with Yahshua like a friend. I'm not going to get into that. We're almost out of time. We got like 10 minutes left.
The last push.
No, I didn't lose my train of thought. What I'm trying to get out is how Yahweh will choose whether to reveal himself or to hide himself from you. And we had it read before that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. We want to be honest in our hearts. He knows the heart of man. And we want to be honest with ourselves in seeking Yahweh, and not for self, because for self is for the flesh. All praises go to Yahweh. We don't just say that because it's the thing to say. It gets into like a ritual type of state when we're coming down to this school, and when you get done with whatever it is that you done talked about, if anything was got out of this, all praises be to Yahweh, like it's a ritual. We ought to really consider that. I think somebody else just recently was up here on the floor, and they said something like, "Wow, you know, I get it." I think it was you. I think it might have been you, Aaron, where you were talking about how I get how all the praises. Yeah, it's an honor and a privilege to get up here, and all the praises go to Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
Like, We really ought to think about these things that we're saying and just not just be a knee jerk, you know, reaction.
Yeah.
Just because we done been down here and, you know, it just seems like the right thing. Well, if I don't say this, then they might not think that I got the Holy Spirit. That's how we get tripped up, thinking about ourselves. When we give the praise back to Yahweh, because we realize there ain't no you, there ain't no me in Yahweh.
But that's what he was saying.
Right.
Is that now, because he became one with that, mm-hmm. he understands
right.
the statements being made. Because it is real, it's real. It is.
Yeah. The truth is being revealed unto all of us.
Yep.
And that's Yahshua. Mm-hmm. That's our comfort. That's our rest in knowing that we know something about the truth about how we are made in the likeness and image of Yahweh our Elohim. And he, like I started to say, he seemed like a long and drawn out thing where you got, you know, the angelic creation and then a war and then Adam being created on, you know, out of the dust of the finer particles of the earth and Eve being drawn out of Adam and her being subject to that ignorance, because this Adam was Yahweh Elohim in a body. He knew all the rules of the game. She didn't know. Being subject to vanity, she was deceived when she seen that tree that was good for fruit, just like the other trees that have fruit. So she partook of that tree and gave it to her husband, and he willingly died. He laid down his life for his bride. And that's the first we got, because now this is how we start off showing the pattern. Because now they're coming down.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In a consciousness. There's a division being made here. They went from being righteous and peace and joy into being condemned into their consciousness and drawn out of the garden to work off of the sweat of their brow, mm-hmm. and would only be brought up through childbearing, necessitating the woman to have to come back to the man.
Right.
Because she would come out of the man, so she's got to come back to the man.
That's right. Just like we do.
And then you had going on in the evil on the earth and the earth being destroyed by a flood. Now, it was just talking about over in Springfield today about how they had some class lecture on a third floor or some building or another. And when they went in there, they had all the charts all set up and everything. And they had noticed that there was rainbows all like shining all over the walls, all throughout the classroom and everything. And one of the women, she said she seen one of the rainbows across this chart. And it was just going right across, I believe, strength is what she quoted, that it was just going right across strength in one way or another. Hmm. And I thought that was beautiful, because that covenant, that rainbow, was a sign showing that he wouldn't destroy the earth again by water. Now, there wasn't no rainbows before that, because it didn't rain before that.
Right.
Didn't rain. No rainbows before that, because it didn't rain. But after that, you got rain. It's simple. It's simple. We wonder, wow, yeah, the rainbow. Well, if it wasn't raining before, it wouldn't be no rainbow before that. Mm-hmm. We got the rainbows and whatever. We moving on. We got, and that was a, you know, a pattern by this whole thing. This ark being an upper deck, lower deck, and upper deck, middle deck, and lower deck. One window, one door. And then you move on to that migratory trek where Abraham coming across the river, he's being told that this land would be the promised land. Canaan land would be the promised land. He would be promised that his seed would inherit this land and would be cast into a land and evilly entreated 400 years And it happened. His seed was cast down here, Joseph, and 400 years they were down there, and it was a death decree put on them people. And that ain't nice. Put a death decree on the male children, two and under. That ain't nice. They were slaves building the treasure cities for Pharaoh. That ain't nice. They didn't have no gold. They didn't have no fancy raiment. They didn't have none of the jewels or anything like that. Pharaoh was hoarding all of that crap. That ain't nice. Moses was raised up in his household. Yahweh found favor. Moses found favor in Yahweh. Thank you very much. I was thinking about that. In the eyes of Yahweh, he was seen to be a goodly child, having the Holy Spirit. And when Pharaoh's daughter seeing him in the ark in the bulrushes at the flags of the brink of the River Nile, she drew him out and it sent him back to his mama to raise him up until he was old enough to be raised up in Pharaoh's household. And then when he was raised up in Pharaoh's household, as he was a man 40 years old, he went back out to his brethren, who he already knew because he was raised up around them. He was raised up on both sides, seen him being evilly treated by some kind of significant Egyptian. We say that it was Pharaoh's son. Slayed that Egyptian, hit him in the sand, and then his brethren went running, yapping their mouth, and they got out. And Moses had to get up out of there. And it was by a purpose that he had to run up out of there and went out there into the wilderness of Sinai and then met Zipporah and got married, had children, worked for his father-in-law, started a whole new life, was out there 40 years minding his own business and came to a burning bush that wasn't being consumed. And the angel of Yahweh appeared to him and commissioned him to go back down here and bring the children out as promised to Abraham. Mm-hmm. Moses was a Jew. He was a Hebrew. We just said that. So he go down there and he poured out 10 devastating. Yahweh poured out 10 devastating plagues on those Egyptians. Three of them hitting the Hebrews too. You got this law over here, this Ten Commandment law in the tablet. You had 7 laws on this side and 3 on the other side. Yahweh being a great mathematician, I can't keep up with all of the math that he done did to make this thing, to tie it all together, to show us some proof. Like we say in this class, come down here and learn something about the proof that all of this was made by the tabernacle, by the pattern of the tabernacle. And that pattern of the tabernacle is the pattern of the universe. You take off that tabernacle, you take off that flesh, and you put on this once you start to know something and you weaned off of the milk. Now, after them 10 devastating plagues was poured out, them children, them Jews had to get up and go up out of this land, and they took all of the raiment and the gold and the jewel, and they didn't know why they was doing it. They just did it because that's what they was told to do, and Yahweh was a mighty God, and he killed the firstborn of all of the Egyptians in the land that didn't have the blood on the door and in them, and it had to be in them. And that lamb having to be in them showed them that this lamb got to be in you, Yahshua the Messiah. We need to learn about him. You learn about him, you learn about this lamb. You learn about this lamb, you learn about the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. And then you go back to the Father, because that's where you're going. That's right. That's where you come from, that's where you're going. That's right. And that's what we're here to learn about. Then they come out, and then Yahweh divide the waters of the Red Sea. And they go through the waters of the Red Sea, and they looking at the cloud, and Pharaoh looking at the people. It was brought up in Springfield earlier. Pharaoh was following the flesh. The children of Israel were following the cloud. Pharaoh was following the flesh. I like that when it was said earlier in Springfield today. I really appreciated it because it brought a light to it, to my understanding of how Pharaoh was following after the flesh, and the flesh profited nothing. They followed the cloud, and they walked through in dry land. Pharaoh and his host was swallowed up in that Red Sea, and they were brought up, and then they were given this law. to be unto their righteousness. Because death, all man died through Adam. So there had to be a way to bring, there had to be a way to bring them back. And none of them children of Israel, like we said, could do it. So we skip all the way down here to Yahshua. On the 30th year, being baptized into his ministry, fulfilling his whole way through, right all the way down, I'm almost done, right all the way down, being nailed to the cross, buried in Joseph New's tomb, resurrected on a phenomenal third day, tarrying with them for 40 days. We're going to have to come back because we got these principles that going all the way down, the blood, water, spirit, and 40, four being a placeholder, tarrying with them for 40 days, and on 50 days, pouring out that Holy Spirit, first on the Jews, and then 7 years later to the Gentiles. How he died. This is the gospel we was reading about over there in Corinthians. How he died according to the scriptures. That's what we down here to do, is learn how he died, buried, and was resurrected. Poured out his Holy Spirit so that you can have life. All right, I'm done. Maybe we'll get back into this pamphlet. I hope that was something was got out of today's workshop. And if so, all praises be to Yahweh, our Elohim, through his only begotten son, Yahshua. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That will conclude this evening's workshop. We still have the two cards out there. We'll leave them out there until Sunday, and then we'll send them off. If anybody would like to sign those cards who hasn't already, then you have the opportunity to do so, and we'll send those off to the families of those taken off the flesh. And that's it. We had no other announcements. So we hold classes here on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is truly the place to learn something truthful about your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Let's all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say hallelujah.